Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Boundless Compassion, Creating a Way of Life by Joyce Rupp. Narrated by Pam Ward. Introduction. Compassion asks us to go where it hurts, to enter places of pain, to share in brokenness, fear, confusion, and anguish. Compassion challenges us to cry out with those in misery, to mourn with those who are lonely, to weep with those in tears. Compassion requires us to be weak with the weak, vulnerable with the vulnerable, and powerless with the powerless. Compassion means full immersion in the condition of being human. Donald McNeil, Douglas Morrison, and Henry Nouwen, Compassion. 13 years ago, I stood at the patio door of my kitchen with the deepest sorrow burrowing into my heart. 5 hours earlier, one of my dearest friends had died of a brain hemorrhage. I was trying to absorb this enormous loss when a hummingbird fluttered in front of my face, just a few inches outside the glass. It hovered there, facing me for several minutes, enough time to convince me that my friend, who treasured these little creatures, was assuring me all would be well. As the tiny bird departed, an inner knowing swept through my being. Love is all that counts. Since that moment, I have never been the same. Because my selfless friend exuded compassionate presence, I had little doubt that message was intended for me. I turned from the patio door, determined to give the rest of my life to living in such a way that compassion would be the most essential focus. 3 years later, I came across a magazine ad that directed my life completely toward that commitment. I noticed that His Holiness the Dalai Lama was scheduled to lead a conference on teaching families how to be compassionate. I have long admired this Tibetan Buddhist leader and what he teaches. This admiration began when I was living in Boulder, Colorado, while attending Naropa, a Buddhist university, during graduate studies. While there, I grew in admiration for Buddhism's dedication to compassion. I left there newly inspired, determined to incorporate this central feature of the world's major religions more fully into my Christian life. As I read the description about the Dalai Lama's workshop, I thought, I really appreciate his wisdom. I wonder who is teaching Christians how to be compassionate. And thus began the greatest challenge and joy of my life, developing and teaching the Boundless Compassion Program. Sister Margaret Stratman, also a servant of Mary, joined me in consulting a variety of persons in caring professions in an effort to gather pertinent information for the program's content and to create a viable structure that would encourage participants to live compassionately. After a year-long consultation, we shaped the Boundless Compassion Program, offering it as either a 4-day conference or a retreat. The 1,200 participants repeatedly confirmed the program's value by assuring us, "Taking part in this study of compassion has changed my life." In co-directing the program, I recognize that the desire to live compassionately requires constant learning and personal renewal. As Christina Feldman writes in Compassion, Listening to the Cries of the World, we are always beginners in the art of compassion. No matter how advanced or refined we believe our understanding to be, life is sure to present us with some new experience or encounter with pain we feel unprepared for. Over and over, you are asked to meet change, loss, injustice. And over, you are asked to find the strength to open when you are more inclined to shut down. There is nothing wimpy or starry-eyed about this essential Christian virtue. Living compassionately is rarely convenient and often downright challenging. It requires a willingness to pay the price for being aware of suffering and doing what is possible to diminish it. The call to compassion has been with me for a long time. A life-size replica of Michelangelo's Pietà rests in a large niche at the front of my religious community's chapel. Ever since my days as a young member, I have felt the call to accompany others in their suffering. When I gaze at the depiction of Mary sitting with the body of her executed son across her lap, I see a mother whose grief weighed like a boulder on her maternal heart. I long to receive those who suffer with the depth of Mary's loving presence. Compassion thrived in the heart of Jesus and in his teachings. If there is one virtue that most exemplifies his life, it is this one. While I esteem the wisdom of various religious traditions that emphasize compassion in their principles, I most of all resonate with those of my beloved teacher, Jesus, a person of immense love. When Jesus urged his followers to be compassionate, he knew what he was asking. Everywhere he went, his awareness of people's suffering became evident. He poured out his love and gave generously of his time, energy, and concern to relieve their pain of body, mind, and spirit. Jesus also challenged those whose policies, regulations, and personal behavior caused or contributed to suffering. As his voice for justice gained strength, so did the voices of those who wanted him destroyed. Jesus knew both the risk and the price to be paid for being committed to compassion. In A Spirituality of Caregiving, Henry Nouwen recognizes this challenge. The gospel call to be compassionate is one that goes right against the grain, that turns us completely around and requires a total conversion of heart and mind. It is indeed a radical call, a call that goes to the roots of our lives. While many Christians have yet to grasp the full significance of a total dedication to compassion, we have an exemplary leader and witness of this commitment in the spirituality of Pope Francis. His courageous teachings and humble actions reveal compassion as a way of life, an inner posture of mind and heart, one meant to infuse our whole being. The following words of Pope Francis demonstrate how his compassionate approach establishes itself in a strong rootedness in following Jesus. This love of God has now been made visible and tangible in Jesus' entire life. His person is nothing but love, a love given gratuitously. The relationships he forms with the people who approach him manifest something entirely unique and unrepeatable. The signs he works, especially in favor of sinners, the poor, the marginalized, the sick, and the suffering, are all meant to teach mercy. Nothing in him is devoid of compassion. This book is not about easy answers, nor does it suggest that we can fix the world's suffering or eliminate it entirely from those closest to us. Rather, Boundless Compassion extends an invitation to grow in the kind of love that motivated Jesus to be a compassionate presence. This love will then flow generously through us into the lives of those who ache for a touch of loving kindness. Each of the 6 weeks' material presents insights and examples of how to enter into situations that contain travail and difficulty. This requires being in touch with how we think, feel, and respond to the suffering residing in ourselves and others, and how we interact with the extensive differences that trouble our world. My friend Kathy commented one day that there is a big difference between a nudge and a shove. A nudge moves us toward growth. A shove initiates resistance. Boundless Compassion is meant to nudge, encourage, and inspire each listener to be a beloved Christ-like presence. Being a living Christ today compels us to embody compassion as he did, to ease suffering, to welcome and aid those who are most vulnerable, and to toil for justice in a global society that wields the heavy weight of domination and oppression. The greatest challenge of compassion may well be that of recognizing the dignity and worth of every person, regardless of race, gender, culture, creed, political stance, or personal behavior. The light of divinity dwells within each one, no matter how hidden that goodness might be. South African Archbishop Desmond Tutu often speaks and writes about the power that this belief can have on how we live. We are fundamentally good. When you come to think of it, that's who we are at our core. What difference does goodness make? Goodness changes everything. Goodness changes how we see the world, the way we see others, and most importantly, the way we see ourselves. The way we see ourselves matters. It affects how we treat people. It affects the quality of life for each and all of us. What is the quality of life on our planet? It is nothing more than the sum total of our daily interactions. Each kindness enhances the quality of life. Each cruelty diminishes it. In today's society, it often seems as if cruelty is more extensive than kindness. Broken, wounded, violent, damaged, divisive. These are some descriptions given to the current global situation. Our world desperately needs the noble, essential quality of compassion to be activated, and will not heal without it. Depending on how we respond, we can increase or decrease the amount of anguish in our world. Only with compassion at the core of humanity's lived experience will we be able to approach one another with true respect and dwell in peacefulness. Suggestions for using this book. The use of boundless compassion depends on what best assists the listener in enriching an understanding of this most basic and essential human attribute. My goal is that each listener will be re-inspired and motivated to live compassionately. Some may find the essays sufficient for their interest. Others may wish to include a more in-depth and integrated method of using this resource. It is to these listeners that I suggest the following. Individual study. You will need to set aside at least 20 minutes to focus on the theme and content for each day. A question for reflection follows each day's content. Before responding to the question, pray for guidance and insight. Welcome silence, and allow the question to take up residence within you. When a response arrives, write this in a notebook or journal so you can look back at the end of the week and recall what emerged for you. A brief prayer follows each reflection. Lastly, a scripture verse awaits for you to tuck in your heart, if you so choose. This serves as a reminder to animate a particular aspect of compassion throughout the day. The seventh day of each week consists of a review to recall what you have integrated during the week. This is not a time for assessing how you performed. Rather, it is an opportunity to pause and remember what you discovered or relearned about compassion. This review helps you to recognize what stirred and called to you and where it led you in the growth of compassion. This is a day for gratitude and rest. Group study. Group gatherings strengthen the study of compassion by kinship, joining in a common cause, and sharing the enriching benefit of one another's insights after a week of study. When each week is completed, the following design for the group's gathering could be used. Begin with an opening prayer or meditation from Prayers of Boundless Compassion. Note: Prayers of Boundless Compassion is an available companion resource containing prayers and meditations related to the topics for each of the 6 weeks in Boundless Compassion. Soren Books, www.avemariapress.com. Return to text. Discuss the past week, using the questions for day 7. Have quiet time to allow the richness of the sharing to be absorbed. Check to see if there is any further input from anyone in the group. Conclude with a prayer from Prayers of Boundless Compassion. Circles of Compassion. After a retreat or conference on compassion, Participants are encouraged to form a circle of compassion to keep both their continued learning and their practice of compassion alive. This is something you might wish to do after completing Boundless Compassion. These circles nurture the bond of kinship among those who value compassion. They also provide encouragement to embody compassion by a study of resources and the sharing of personal experiences in living compassionately. Circles meet once a month for 2 hours. The following format is one that has evolved and is now used by past participants of the Boundless Compassion retreats and conferences. Opening meditation of 10 minutes. The form of this to be decided by the circle. Meditations from prayers for boundless compassion could be used. Personal sharing in groups not larger than 3. 5 minutes is allowed for each person. The sharing is based on this question. How have I experienced or not experienced compassion during the past month? Application of listening skills and compassionate presence are essential for this sharing. This is a faith-sharing time, not a counseling or therapeutic session. The content of the small group is confidential and not brought to the large group. Discussion of a resource related to the topic of compassion is then held for the remaining time. Close with a blessing or prayer led by the facilitator of the circle. Week 1. Compassion as a way of life. Introduction. Day 1. Awareness, attitude, action. Day 2. The seeds of compassion. Day 3. Behind every scar, a story. Day 4. Responding nonviolently. Day 5. Forgiveness is a journey. Day 6. Staying awake. Day 7. Review and rest. Introduction. The joys and hopes, the sorrows and anxieties of the women and men of this age, especially the poor and those afflicted in any way, are the joys and hopes, the sorrows and anxieties of the followers of Jesus Christ. Vatican II, Gaudium et Spes. In my early 20s, the first line of this Vatican II document on the Church, Gaudium et Spes, Latin for joy and hope, aroused a vision in my heart of how I wanted to live. Ever since then, this hope has formed a motivation for my steadfast longing to respond compassionately to those whose lives bear sorrows and anxieties, to bring joy and hope to those afflicted in any way. Paul Gilbert, professor at Derby University, describes compassion as being sensitive to the suffering of self and others with a deep commitment to try to prevent or relieve it. This week we explore some of the basic components of doing this. I invite you to consider what compassion consists of in its most basic nature. This includes exploring the movement of compassion, awareness, attitude, and action, and the four essential aspects of non-judgment, nonviolence, forgiveness, and mindfulness. Compassion is a way of life, an inner posture of how to be with suffering, both our own and others, and a desire to move that attitude into action. Compassion involves an inside-out movement. A radical change unfolds in us when compassion becomes a way of life, a transformation as far-reaching as an acorn growing into a tree, an egg producing a chicken, or a caterpillar metamorphosing into a butterfly. Each of the practices of compassion presented this week holds the possibility of changing how we think, how we respond emotionally, and what choices we make in regard to others and our planet. We cannot accomplish this transformation on our own. Only with divine love empowering us and a daily renewal of intention, will we be insistent and persistent in our efforts to live in a compassionate manner. My experience with compassion has taught me that activating this virtue is both a challenge and an immense gift. I know that my intent to be compassionate has changed me. I have become more generous with my presence, less begrudging of the time required to be there for another. Negative criticism and judgment of others has waned considerably, and in their place has grown a greater acceptance and appreciation for those who think and act differently than I do. My understanding of the pain that our planet and non-humans endure steadily expands. At the same time, I am always learning more about what compassion requires. One of the ongoing strengths of compassion rests on the foundation of our unity with this world, of which we are a part. We are never alone in our practice of compassion. At the same time, we continually receive what we need to sustain our life and our love. As meditation teacher Norman Fisher reminds us, literally every thought in our minds, every emotion that we feel, every word that comes out of our mouth, every material sustenance that we need to get through the day, comes through the kindness of and the interaction with others. And not only other people, but non-humans too, literally the whole of the earth, the soil, the sky, the trees, the air we breathe, the water we drink. We not only depend on all of this, we are all of it, and it is us. Keeping this bountiful support in view helps us to meet the challenges that compassion brings with it. Each day that we give ourselves to living compassionately, we will need a trustful patience. With the exception of biologists and a few other interested human beings, most of us never pay attention to photosynthesis, that phenomenal gift of the sun to change light into food. This process takes time. Plants do not grow into full stature overnight. Some, like trees, take years to reach their full height and fruitfulness. Matt Malone, S.J., editor-in-chief of America magazine, alludes to this reality by relating the story of Hubert Lutie, who once suggested to his gardener that he plant a tree. The gardener objected. "This particular tree will not flower for 100 years. To this, the former French army general replied, "In that case, plant it this afternoon." We presume that we must wait for a tree to grow. This is true also with our desire to be persons who contribute to a lessening of the world's suffering. Compassion is the photosynthesis of the heart. It too requires the slow, trusting process of waiting for change to occur. We cannot hurry this transformation, but we can give ourselves to it as fully as possible, knowing that it entails a continual recommitment. Mindfulness is a valuable means of maintaining and strengthening our resolve to begin anew each day. Day 6 presents the value of this spiritual practice to keep us alert, so that we are aware of suffering and how we choose to respond to it. As you reflect on the topics of this week, be patient with yourself. Trust that you have a divine companion who both inspires and guides you along the way. Week 1, Day 1. Awareness, Attitude, Action. Compassion is a thread that binds together the deepest centers of life beyond the borders of race, gender, religion, tribe, or creature. Ilya de Leo, OSF, Compassion. Awareness, Attitude, Action. These three essentials comprise the movement of compassion. While much of the world's suffering is observable, a portion lies tightly concealed. Unless we become aware of suffering, we cannot respond to it compassionately. One day, in a supermarket, I met an acquaintance whom I rarely see. She smiled and commented on life being good in reply to my "How are you?" 3 minutes into our conversation, her tears fell as she spoke about the helplessness of seeing her parents aging. Another time, at Mass on a Lenten morning, a stranger in a business suit sat next to me, seemingly content, until a cell phone behind us rang incessantly. The man turned around and hissed, "Throw the damn thing out the door!" Only at the sign of peace did I catch a glimpse of what disturbed his spirit. A woman came over to him and whispered, "Good luck on your deposition today." Ah, there it was, the hidden anxiety and concern about what lay ahead of him. Compassion also requires a certain attitude, that of recognizing the inviolable oneness we have with all of life. We exist in a world of interconnectedness. We are not isolated individuals, even if we may feel that way at times. The suffering of one affects the suffering of all. What we think and feel about people who are suffering, especially if they do not match our notions of how they ought to believe and act, greatly affects our response. The indwelling light of divinity unites us at a spiritual level. If I intend to be compassionate, I cannot shove people I dislike out of the way. I relearned this one morning sitting in prayer at dawn, watching charcoal clouds press heavily against the eastern horizon. In spite of this barrier, a strong, thin edge of brilliant red light arose. This persistent light led me inward to where disgust toward a political leader lodged. His hard-hearted approach to society's most vulnerable people walled off my thinking kindly about him. As I observed the narrow band of light, I remembered Jessica Powers's poem about the Holy One sitting on a ledge of light in her soul. With that, the spirit of love opened my walled-off heart, and I thought, this politician, too, has a ledge of light in his heart, even though I cannot see it. Soften what has concretized in yourself. This insight did not mean accepting his non-compassionate rhetoric and heartless actions, but it did call me to look beneath that behavior and respect the light at the core of his being. Later that morning, I received confirmation of my insight when I opened Krista Tippett's Becoming Wise and read a comment by Congressman John Lewis of Georgia. "You have to be taught the way of peace, the way of love, the way of nonviolence. In the religious sense, in the moral sense, you can say that in the bosom of every human being there is a spark of the divine. So you don't have a right as a human to abuse that spark of the divine in your fellow human being. If you have someone attacking you, beating you, spitting on you, you have to think of that person. Years ago, that person was an innocent child, an innocent little baby. What happened? Did something go wrong? Did someone teach that person to hate, to abuse others? You try to appeal to the goodness of every human being, and you don't give up. You never give up on anyone." Research by quantum physicists like David Bohm assures us that we are also united on a physical plane by a bond of invisible connections. Our physical self consists of invisible energy packets of light and heat called photons. Instead of our bodies being a solid mass, scientists now know that every particle is in motion. Every part connects and interrelates with each other. Lynn McTaggart summarizes this research in The Bond. "The more scientists look, the more they discover how dependent on, and finally indivisible from, everything is with everything else. We are beings who intermingle in an undetectable way with one another." Amazing indeed. This attitude of a common bond underlies each compassionate action. With our awareness of suffering and an attitude of wanting to alleviate it, we then choose to act in a positive way for the benefit of all beings. We trust that each action taken for the good of one person or group benefits the good of all, that as we read in Gaudium et Spes, "The sorrows and anxieties of the women and men of this age are the sorrows and anxieties of the followers of Jesus Christ." This three-step approach can clearly be seen when Jesus approaches the widow of Nain. See Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 17. He becomes aware of her suffering when he sees her crying at the death of her son. He had compassion for her and said to her, "Do not weep." Luke chapter 7, verse 13. His heart is moved because he recognizes a human being like himself who knows loss and sorrow. This elicits loving kindness in him and a desire to end her suffering. Jesus then acts by raising the son back to life. We look beneath surface appearances when we are compassionate. Like Congressman Lewis, we trust the spark of divinity dwelling in humanity. On the surface, we may seem to exist at a great distance from each other. Underneath that cover of disparity lies the treasure of our oneness. The deeper down we go, the more alike we are than different. Each of us desires happiness. Each of us knows fear and the pain of non-acceptance. Each of us wants to have a loving home in the heart of another. In the wise words of conservationist Carl Safina, the greatest story is that all of life is one. Reflection. Of the three components of compassion, awareness, attitude, action, which do you find most difficult to live? What makes this challenging for you? How might you approach this so that it becomes less difficult? Prayer. Imagine that a ledge of light exists in the vast abode of yourself. You are sitting on that ledge. An embodied, compassionate presence comes and joins you. As the two of you sit together, on each in-breath, whisper quietly, "I am filled with compassion." Scripture to carry in your heart today. Clothe yourselves with compassion. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Week 1, Day 2. The Seeds of Compassion. What we repeatedly think shapes our world. Out of compassion, substitute healthy thoughts for unhealthy ones. Jack Kornfield, The Wise Heart. At the opening of a retreat on compassion, I handed each participant a small transparent pouch containing 4 seeds. I reminded them that the seemingly inert seeds held the potential for an abundant harvest if they were carefully tended. I asked the group to consider the seeds as symbols of the 4 main spiritual qualities necessary for compassion's growth: non-judgment, non-violence, forgiveness, and mindfulness. The more these seeds are nurtured, the greater the harvest of compassion. Enlivening these 4 aspects requires deliberate practice, interior stamina, and trust in the power of the Holy One to assist in their development. When we look into the Gospels, it doesn't take long to find numerous teachings of Jesus related to these qualities. "Do not judge, so that you may not be judged," Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. "Forgive not 7 times, but 77 times," Matthew chapter 18, verse 22. "If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also," Luke chapter 6, verse 29. "Keep awake," Mark chapter 13, verse 35. Neuroscience lends credence to both the challenge and the possibility of bringing these seeds to life. We now know that every human being is born with a potential for being compassionate. Sometimes severe psychological trauma in early childhood damages this ability to sense the suffering of others. But for the majority of people, this seed waits to be generative. Authors such as Paul Gilbert, Rick Hansen, and Daniel Siegel, M.D., have explored the connection between the brain and its ability to activate compassion. Gilbert writes, "Understanding our minds is perhaps one of the greatest challenges for modern science and each of us personally. It's our minds that will create grasping selfishness, pitting group against group, or an open, reflective, cooperative, and sharing approach to these difficulties. And, of course, it is our minds that are the source of our own personal experiences of happiness and joy, or anxiety, misery, and despair." Neuroscientists once thought that brain cells lost an ability to adapt once a person reached a certain age. Now they teach the theory of neuroplasticity, which assures the possibility of brain cells changing throughout our lifetime. Research in the area of meditation, for example, has found that neurons or nerve cells in the part of the brain affected by meditation are much thicker and stronger for those who meditate daily for lengthy periods. Any thought or action we do repeatedly will strengthen that part of the brain, as Daniel Siegel notes in MindSight. One of the key practical lessons of modern neuroscience is that the power to direct our attention has within it the power to shape our brain's firing patterns, as well as the power to shape the architecture of the brain itself. A common saying among neuroscientists when they speak of this is, neurons that fire together wire together. The more that nerve cells transmit information through electrical and chemical signals called synapses, the sturdier those areas of the brain become. We are capable of changing what we think and how we respond. The more intentionally we concentrate on being non-judgmental, non-violent, and forgiving, the stronger our possibility of being able to respond that way becomes. For instance, if I am having difficulty in trying to be less judgmental about someone, I can reduce that negativity by consciously intending to notice my thoughts about that person and then choosing to alter them if they are not kind. As I do so repeatedly, the neurons in that area of my brain gain strength in their ability to be less judgmental. Awareness of my thoughts increases, and I am more conscious of where I let those thoughts lead me. I know this is possible from personal experience. In my youth, I observed how adults I admired dealt with difficult relationships by using the scissors method. Instead of entering into dialogue when conflicts arose, they simply cut off the lines of communication by their silence or by completely ending the relationship. Snip, snip, snip. No more connection. So,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.